Thank you for coming tonight. It's a pleasure to be here. I want to start by giving you an idea what are the laws of Sharia pertaining to blasphemy and apostasy. The blasphemy and apostasy laws are very interlinked. And it's important to understand these laws. So let's start by identifying these laws. Sharia makes apostasy and blasphemy the number one sin in Islam. Leaving Islam is the number one sin. Criticizing, asking questions, doubting the religion, or criticizing or asking something that Muhammad has done is automatically regarded as blasphemy. And if you commit blasphemy, you are automatically considered an apostate. And so the number one sin in Islam is not murder, is not lying, is not the normal sins like the Ten Commandments. The number one sin is to leave Islam. And being a Muslim really is not something that you choose to do, like when you're a Christian, you go get baptized as an adult, and you choose to be a Christian as an adult. Or you're a Jew, and when you're 13, you get the bar mitzvah, and you go study the religion, and you're convinced into being a Christian. Being a Muslim is by birth. You're automatically, your birth certificate in Egypt, when I was born, it was stamped Muslim. And you are a Muslim. And being a Muslim really is not a relationship with God. It's a contract with the state. You are obliged to go to a mosque, to behave like a Muslim, and to abide by the laws of Sharia, because you're born in the religion. And if you are, let's say there was a case in Egypt that was very recent, where a man wanted his wife was pregnant, and it was the first time in Egyptian history that a man went to court wanting to name his son a Christian name and did not want the birth certificate to be stamped Muslim. And guess what happened to this man? He was condemned by the court as an apostate, as a rebel, and as an illegitimate person that should be killed. And he was denied naming his son a Christian name and having the freedom to send his child, his own flesh and blood, to church. This happens in Egypt today. And this happened under the laws before the revolution, not after the Muslim Brotherhood took over. It's now worse, because now they want the application of Sharia by the government, not just by the people. By the way, Sharia, the laws of Sharia, are in the people's hands also to enforce it. The tricky part and the sad part about Sharia is that it is not left in the hands of the government alone to do it. Muslims are forgiven for 3 murders. Can you believe it? People on the street in Egypt, in any Muslim, and you wonder why there's honor killing? There is 3 murders that a Muslim will be forgiven for. Number one, killing an apostate, which is me. And that's why apostates cannot go to any Muslim country and visit it. I can never go and visit a Muslim country, because it is legal under the law for anybody on the street to kill me. Whether it's Turkey, Saudi Arabia, the government will arrest me and kill me. In Egypt, anybody on the street can kill me, and he'll be a hero. And it happened to many free thinkers and journalists who were accused of blasphemy. And blasphemy is automatically an apostasy. And that's how these free thinkers were stabbed and killed and assassinated, and this is very common. I just recently, I've been calling many relatives and many people I know in Egypt, because I wanted to know what's going on with all the, what we're seeing on TV today. And I was talking to several people, not just one person, several people. Every person I talk to is talking about the weather, is talking about anything but what's going on in the streets. I mean, in front of their homes, there are, bombings, and people are getting killed, and there is, tear gas flying around. And I call them and talk to them. This is tyranny, ladies and gentlemen. Is when people cannot talk to me on the phone on what's going on. They are afraid of being arrested for blasphemy of Islam. This is the effect of blasphemy laws in Sharia on people. And that is when I was talking to my cousin, and I wanted to ask him, what's going on in the streets? This is ridiculous. And he would say, don't you know, Nani, did you forget we can't talk about these things on the phone? That was just yesterday. And this man is a doctor. This is not just poor people who are ignorant. This is my family who are educated people. So that just gives you an idea of the effects of something called blasphemy laws. And these people don't even know why they think this way. To them, this is normal. If a country has blasphemy laws on its books and effective for 1,300 years, like Egypt, since Egypt was occupied by the Arabs and Islamized, Egypt never saw its glory days again since Islam conquered Egypt. We don't have queens anymore like we used to have 1,400 years ago. Egypt is a sad third world country now after Islam took over. People cannot, they don't talk politics, even educated people. People are suspicious of one another. They don't trust each other because a parent can kill a daughter. A father can kill a son for blasphemy. Because Islam turns the family against each other. So people are scared to talk. And I was speaking to those people on the phone yesterday, and all they were talking about was the weather, while people are being killed on the streets. This is tyranny, ladies and gentlemen. This is blasphemy laws. And I want to give you an idea about these laws, how elaborate they are. Little things can make you a blasphemer. There are children being arrested, Christians being arrested and put in jail and put on a death penalty, awaiting being killed in the Muslim world today for blasphemy, for somebody saying they insulted Muhammad. And they don't have to be Muslim. These laws apply not to Muslims, to anybody. So you could be a Christian woman in Pakistan, and somebody said, she insulted my prophet. The whole neighborhood goes to the house of that woman, take her, grab her, drag her in the street to the police, and they arrest her. And it happened, and she's awaiting execution. This is real life, ladies and gentlemen. There's many, many cases all over the world. There's children who are arrested and beaten for an accusation of blasphemy. There is a Filipino woman in a Gulf country, a Filipino maid actually, who her employers took her to the police and said to the police that she was sitting on a Quran. A Quran was placed on a sofa somehow, and she sat on it. And guess what happened to her? 4 months in jail and shipped back to the Philippines without getting paid. That's blasphemy laws. I remember as a child, I asked a simple question about the religion that I was born in. I think the question was, why do we hate Jews? What are they? Are they monsters? And the teacher looked at me with a red face and anger. How dare you say that? Aren't you a Muslim? You doubt that the Jews are not evil people? How could you? And you learn to be silent. I was not as outspoken as I am now. It took me years. I've been living in America for 34 years. And it took decades for me to really realize that, oh boy, I can speak out. Because I was living under Sharia law in America, in my mind. This is the effect of Sharia. But blasphemy against Islam is illegal and punishable by death. If the blasphemy is insulting Muhammad, the law states that you will be executed even if you repent. So Muhammad especially, above God and above the Quran, and above, if Muhammad is insulted, the death penalty has to happen even if the person apologizes. It doesn't matter, it's too late. So you can't even apologize for it. Muhammad was a very sensitive man. He really hated to be insulted. And let me tell you, he killed a lot of people for it during his time. And his followers made it a law that even after his death, we will kill anybody who insults him, because he was very sensitive. And it happened. Even if you repent. And guess the religion that hates insulting? It gave itself the right to insult other people, especially Jews. So insulting Muhammad, insulting Islam, is at the highest crime under Islam, whether you're a Muslim or a Christian. You will be killed. But I grew up as a Muslim, and I, every Friday prayer ended in the same thing. May God destroy the Jews and the enemies of Allah, those apes and pigs and the enemies of Allah. And the sheikh would bang and yell and tell us not to befriend them or make peace with them or make treaties with them. They are subhuman and they are cursed and cursing and cursing. I grew up with cursing from my religious leaders, from my political leaders. These are the same people who will kill me if I'll kill you if you hint at something offensive for Muhammad. For instance, it is blasphemy to accuse Muhammad of something that he really did. If you say that Muhammad married a six-year-old and consummated the marriage at 9 years old, and that is child abuse, you have committed blasphemy in the Muslim world, even though it's true. Muhammad had slaves. Muhammad killed with his own hand. But dare you say it in a negative way? So it's the way you say it. Do you know that this film that just came out, the trailer, it was very offensive, it was cheap, it was done in a very bad way, okay? We all agree about that. But all the stories in it are true. And guess where? Who said them, these stories? Guess who said them? It is Muslim scriptures who were written in the 8th century by Muslim authority and Muslims who worship these books. But dare you put them in a movie just the same way Muhammad said it happened? Then the movie is an insult to Muslims. So Muslims are very insulted if you just state a fact. Slander and exaggeration and lying are not good under Judeo-Christian culture, right? However, under Islam in Muslim scriptures, and I'm quoting from page 737 in a mainstream Sharia book. Okay, this is not what I'm saying. This is what Muslims are saying. You're obliged to lie if the purpose is obligatory. Slander is permissible. There's two or three pages of permissible slander in Islamic legal books and Islamic scriptures. Legal slander. Do you wonder why in Arab TV on a daily basis you hear the Jews, Israel went to Haiti to help, they said they came to help with the earthquake. But do you know why, this was on Syrian TV, do you know why Israel went to help in the Haitian earthquake? Yes, and they are very serious thinkers and sheikhs sitting on TV, in Arab TV, and all the Arab children are watching. It's because Israel went there to harvest the organs of the Haitian people. Slander, permissible slander. There is no coincidence in the Muslim world. There is no coincidence why slander is used on a daily basis on Arab TV. It's not a coincidence. It's legal. It's not just legal. You're obliged to do it if it's for the benefit of Islam. But there, the Jews and the Christians slander Muslims. There are laws in Sharia making it illegal for Christians to slander Muslims or to hint at they cannot curse a Muslim or say anything, and I'm quoting from Sharia books. There is a law that states, non-Muslims cannot curse a Muslim, say anything derogatory about Allah, the Prophet, or Islam, or expose the weak points of Muslims, even if it's true. But there is no law prohibiting Muslims from cursing non-Muslims. So you guys cannot curse them, but they can curse you on their Arab TV day and night. That's what their law says. You're apes and pigs and enemies of Allah, and we are not to befriend you or make treaties with you, truly. We can make treaties with you only when we do this. Okay? That's the only kind of treaty we can have with you, because you're subhuman. That's how we feel about you. And that's why I left the religion, because I could not make peace with the rest of the world as a Muslim. I could not. And this is what the infection we are getting by Sharia. A lot of people think that Sharia, you know, with its blasphemy laws, its apostasy laws, is just a religious right. You know, it's our religious right to practice our religion in America. We need to practice our Sharia, it's our religious right. But what about the law that states that an apostate must be killed, and a girl or a woman who commits adultery, she can be killed by her husband? These are laws that are totally against our Bill of Rights in America. How are we going to reconcile this? Something has to give. Is it going to be us or them? Well, they believe this is their religious right to kill and to, you know, jihad is killing. The definition of jihad is to war with non-Muslims to establish the religion. That's not my opinion, that's the Sharia books. And this is what it is. For the sake of jihad, we have to commit blasphemy, we have to curse, and anything is legal if it's for the benefit of Islam. Killing, cursing, lying, exaggeration, and you name it, anything is legal. But slander is okay if it's against Jews and Christians and non-Muslims. Slander is okay. But dare you slander us? How could you say, don't you like Muslims? Why do you speak against us like that? Why do you say all Muslims are evil and they're all terrorists? Did I say all Muslims are terrorists now? I'm speaking about an ideology and a legal system. I'm not speaking about people. And I can say this 10 times, and at the end, there's always one person that comes up and tells me, but how could you criticize people like that? I'm not speaking again about people. I'm speaking about an ideology, like speaking against Nazism or communism or whatever ism. Muslims, there's good and bad in everything. I'm not, there are some of the nicest people I know are Muslims, so please don't give me a question now telling me, are you insulting Muslim people? Okay, because this is the way they get away and dilute the discussion about an ideology and an oppressive legal system and make me try to look like the villain, okay? So it's very important. And to just conclude, before to conclude that, President Obama, my heart sank when I heard him in the UN say that in his recent speech in the UN, he said, the future must not belong to those who slander the Prophet of Islam. My heart sank because we apostates in America, we thought we lived in America under our constitution. But this statement from our president has made Sharia legitimate. I'm very scared for myself when Obama said that. I'm very scared for my security because the President of the United States called me a slanderer of the Prophet Muhammad because I left Islam. And I must never dare slander. Only they can slander. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, anybody that has any questions or compliments or criticisms or denunciations, we're going to have a microphone on that side over there, so we can have a lineup starting over there for some dialogue with our panelists. And the organizer of our event, Kazra, has got a few words to say.